opinions collide, Bill Kelly harnesses the spark and sets your radio ablaze with engaging talk. This is The Bill Kelly Show on 900 CHML.
Have a banana, Hannah. Try the salami, Tommy.
Welcome back. Bill Kelly Show, 900 CHML. Well, there is a fundraiser, and I guess I could categorize this as well as a memorial service for a very, very famous Hamilton resident who passed away just about a year ago now, who I worked with on Hamilton City Council for quite a long time. And of course, we're talking about Marvin Kaplan, who used to be the city councilor for Ward 1 out in the west end of the city for the longest time. He was a clothier. He was a entrepreneur. He was a quite a unique individual. He passed away January 31st. Well, this event that we're talking about here right now is something kind of different. It's called Taste Buds Cabaret. And to explain a little bit about what you're going to be seeing when you attend, we've got a great panel of folks in here to talk about this. Rabbi Hillel Lavery Israeli is with us from Beth Jacob Synagogue. Rabbi, it's great to see you again. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
Peter Tegelhauer, a monk with the Benedictines and a musician. We'll explain that in a couple of minutes. Peter, good to have you here.
Thanks. Great to be here.
And the MC for the festivities that evening will be our dear friend Deirdre Pike, of course, from the Social Planning and Research Council, who is also with us in studio. Good to see you again.
Thanks, Bill. Good to be here. Now, we're just on a microphone there.
Well, good to have you with us all to talk about this. So we're just trying to find out exactly where this idea came from. And the consensus was this was the rabbi's concept about doing something like this. But it's really kind of an offshoot of something you did last year, right?
Right. So about a year ago, what was it? It was in March, I think, right? We had the blessing of coexistence. It was a response to anti-Semitic and Islamophobic attacks in this part of Canada, I guess, and in Quebec and so on. And we came together, members of different religions, at Beth Jacob to hold a prayer service of solidarity and show that we all want to be together in Canada, living in peace and helping each other out. And it was a great event, well attended and so on. And it's about a year later, time to do another one. There's stuff going on again, unfortunately, time to come together again. But this time we're doing it in memory and to honor the memory of Marvin Kaplan, as you said.
Deirdre, let's talk a little bit about Taste Buds, and then I want to talk a little bit about Marvin and the tie-in there, because there is a pretty strong tie-in. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, you know, Taste Buds, the Student Nutrition Collaborative in Hamilton, feeding over 34,000 students a day. So today, as we sit here across Hamilton, 34,000 students will have access to breakfast, lunch, snack programs at over 100 schools because of Taste Buds and a plethora of volunteers, you know, over 1,000 volunteers. With very little funding from the Ontario government, we receive 15% of the total cost of running these programs. And so our role, and when I say our role, I'm with the Social Planning and Research Council, and Taste Buds lives at the Social Planning Council. It's one of the programs that we've helped to incubate in this community, and so it runs out of our organization, and so we're responsible for fundraising 85% of the cost of feeding 34,000 students a day. And so, of course, it is good for us to have advocates, and Marvin Kaplan, as the president of the Social Planning Council at the time of his death, but a longtime advocate over our five decades, was a big fan of universally delivered programs that did not stigmatize children, that really allowed access and furthering all the good things that could happen to them as residents of Hamilton. And he was all for that. And so when the rabbi was looking for a worthy place to donate money that might be raised from this kind of activity, it was a beautiful marriage, really.
Now, Peter, you and the rabbi actually met last year.
We met at that gathering in March, and I'd heard about that gathering through a connection with the Sisters of St. Joseph that I'm connected with. There's a bit of background of that, which I won't go into, but I found out about it from them, and I'm what's called the Benedictine Oblate, and one of the things that we practice regularly is the singing of the Psalms, which is a common ground we would have with our Jewish friends. And I offered to bring a psalm, 122, to that event. And I took a ukulele along and discovered that the rabbi and I both had this obsession with small instruments. we're both
you're both frustrated musicians.
Oh well, no, I
not so frustrated really.
I think there was a camaraderie that started around our mandolins and ukulele and hammer tone and stick dulcimers, all these different instruments. And really, it was an opportunity to nurture a friendship around music, but also just like Christian from I'm actually a Protestant background, but I found my way into the Benedictine stream. It's always been of interest to me to develop the First Nation, friendship with other people like First Nations and Jews. And at the time of this event, I was really moved to come and participate in that.
And this is actually kind of a multi-faith band that you guys are playing with right now, because there's a little bit of everything here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we called our band the Mixed Blessings. Kind of
good name.
And we have myself and Peter. We have a very talented accordion and keyboard player, Jordan Abraham. We have a Juno Award-winning bass player, upright bass player, Anna Anna Ruddick.
Ruddick, yeah.
And a drummer named Tom, and singers and so on. And just now we heard that there's going to be, in addition to our act, also a Muslim singer. So we're really looking forward to that. That's
cool.
The musical side of the event. And we also have a tremendous dance side of the event. Also, we have dance performers from a number of dance companies, Canadian Dance Company in Burlington, not just another dance studio up on the mountain here in Hamilton. We have two ballet dancers from the Hamilton Conservatory for the Arts, Ingrid and Margaret Askey, who are going to do a scene from Swan Lake and a scene of a piece that we put together ourselves from some traditional Jewish melodies. And we have a classical Indian dancer named Arvith Girard, who's going to do some classical Indian dance. It's going to be a tremendous evening. I hope I haven't forgotten anyone. But
well, Rabbi, I know that you want to keep it a secret, but I think it might help in ticket sales if we say that, you know, the MC might bring her guitar along and, you know, pick up do a piece or two from the band maybe, or some other Canadian classic. So it's worth $15. I'm pretty sure just for that.
I think Deirdre brings a guitar to everything she does.
Wait till I bring my trumpet.
It's always one of those things. Well, if you really want me to, I can do a couple of songs. Okay. So you do? Okay. All right. So I just happen to have a couple rehearsed.
Yeah,
so
that's
it's going to be fun. Now, I got to tell you, the affiliation with Marvin here, I want to get into with Marvin Kaplan. Because, I worked with Marvin on City Council. I knew him before that.
Hmm.
Marvin actually was from Toronto originally and came to Hamilton like so many other folks did and fell in love with the city right away. He had a gentleman's clothier store, Marvin Kaplan Gentleman's Apparel, which was right downtown in the old Terminal Towers building. And that's where I first met him. I was a customer. Now, you go in there and get stuff. And, of course, he used to advertise here on the radio station back in the 90s when I was here. And so I got to know him then. But then we were colleagues on City Council. And our offices were right side by side. And I can tell you on a first-hand basis that he loved music.
Mm.
Because every time I was trying to get any work done, the walls were very thin. And he was blasting Sam and Dave CDs all the time. Well, he was basically whatever it was he was doing with his constituents, too. So I know he had this love of music constantly. And of course, it runs in the family. His son, Ben, of course, is a very successful musician these days. So it would make sense. And I think it's a natural progression. To do a kind of a memorial slash fundraiser for one of his favorite charities for Taste Buds in a musical vein, because that was always a very big part of his life.
Mm-hmm. And we did have a great conversation with Ben, too, who, is supporting us through different ideas for this event and, you know, possibly helping us down the line. But, of course, music is there for Marvin. The other thing, you mentioned, clearly you used to be, or maybe you still are, it's radio, folks, you don't know, a well-dressed man. If you shopped at his store, and tonight, and we're asking on Sunday night, some folks are going to be wearing bow ties in memory of Marvin.
That was his trademark.
Who had a trademark. Mark idea around bow ties.
I have a bow tie. Better start practicing.
All right, Peter. Good. I hope you can play and wear a bow tie.
And by the way,
time.
I got to tell you, it was not a fake bow. I mean, Marvin was one for authenticity. He did the whole thing where you had to tie it and everything else.
Right. And now, the other cool connection, Bill, is that Marvin also liked food. And we feed 34,000 students a day. And the key connection here that we're interested in that's going to happen after this concert is that the Social Justice Committee at Beth Jacob wants to carry on their commitment to Taste Buds in Marvin's name, and they're going to be using some healthy muffin recipes, and they're adopting a school. We haven't figured out which one yet, but they're going to be adopting a school and baking muffins for a student nutrition program, and so this partnership is going to carry on. And so the, you know, everything that they're doing in terms of, it's not just a one-night stand that we're having this concert on Sunday night. There is a commitment, in the same way Marvin made a commitment, you made a commitment, people who do this kind of thing for a, you know, with a lifelong vision of justice.
Mm-hmm. We talked about, obviously, that the bow tie is a trademark, and Marvin's personality, which was just such an ebullient individual. I mean, you knew when Marvin was in the room all the time. I mean, that's just the way he was. But I think one of the hallmarks, and you guys remember all of this from the years that he was on city council, was a champion of social causes. He always made that. I can remember a debate that he got into with an individual who worked at this radio station at the time, not me, about social causes and about people should give more to social causes to lift up people that are in need of help. And the individual that was doing the show disagreed with that, and he got into a whale of a debate with Marvin about it on the air one day, more than once. But it showed me just how adamant and sincere Marvin was about that. I mean, this is a guy that was making a pretty good living as a clothier at that time and eventually as a city councilor. But he believed in lifting people up. And I know that one of the committees I worked on with him for the years that we worked together on city council was the public health committee and the social services committee. And he was a strong advocate for Fraser Mustard's Healthy Babies, Healthy Mothers program, about the needle exchange program long before people understood just how important something like that was. He would champion that, and he took a lot of heat for that, but he knew that it was the right thing to do. And that's, I think, the legacy that a lot of us remember about Marvin.
That's right, and the fact that he took that even past his time on council and volunteered then at the planning council to be a leader in carrying on those sorts of systemic changes that he wanted to see in the community, not just charity, but also the justice side of that. And I believe that, you know, it's clear to me that he gets that from his roots in Judaism. And I think, Rabbi, maybe it would be really a good time for you to say what he was doing when he died.
Yeah, I was just about to say that, actually. An hour before he died, I got an email from him. It was, we had that attack on a mosque. And he emailed me an hour before he died, literally, to say, what are we as the Jewish community going to do to show our support and our response? And I emailed him back. And I hope he saw it, that that I had already sent a letter, which was received by the Muslim community here. And this was on his mind as he moved on to the next world.
Well, and that doesn't surprise me at all, just based on the way he acted and the way he did. And the nice thing about Marvin, too, that, you know, he just didn't talk the talk. He was sincere about this. I mean, he used to go around, you know, during these bitterly cold nights, and we're having a few of them right now too. He would go on those all-night trips with the public health crews that would look for people on the street and offer them help, whether it was a shelter or whether it was a blanket or whatever the case might be. He was always hands-on with things like that to see what he could do to try to help those that needed help here in this community. Which, to that end, it's no surprise at all that he got involved in the Taste Buds program.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And he, you know, it's a particular concern to programs across Ontario, really, but here right in Hamilton, where we still could fill First Ontario Place now, formerly Cops Coliseum, five times with the number of people who live in poverty. And so while these student nutrition programs are for all students in school, we don't see it as something that needs to be an economic divide. We know, and Marvin knew, how important it was to pay particular attention to those schools in areas that were particularly disadvantaged. And so he made that a purpose in terms of his role at the Planning Council to see what can be done about getting further funding to make sure that these are universally delivered programs. And, you know, that's what makes Canada unique. Our healthcare is delivered universally. These sorts of things that we do, you know, when you're sitting in a doctor's office, you all have OHIP. You don't know whether that person is living in a mansion or in a shelter. You're there to receive the same care because it's delivered non-stigmatizing. And Marvin believed in that principle, and Taste Buds is run on that principle. And I think all of this fits in so well. And I think the fact that the musical agenda is connected even to that universal program, to come out of an event that was about hatred against Muslim people, to hold that in unity at a synagogue. And that night last year was the first time that this imam that we had, he had ever stepped into a synagogue. It was really remarkable.
And wow, now, when he chanted and prayed, it was like the hair stood on the back of my neck. It was just an awesome moment in our city to have this imam saying a prayer in a synagogue.
Yeah.
And that to me is that's a social issue. That's a justice issue, that there's friendships of that sort. And that's what Hillel and I have been trying to nurture musically and otherwise. And I'd like to see that grow in our city with amongst these groups. I'd like to see a growth in... I was really took some inspiration from a picture in the cover of The Speck of the woman with the wampum on me.
Yeah.
And that wampum representing two people groups, you know, side by side, coexisting. That's, I think, the cutting edge of growth, spiritual, emotionally, in our city, is to see that kind of thing happen. And I think that's cool what Hillel's been incubating and nurturing there at Beth Jacob, and I'd love to see that whole thing grow throughout our city.
Well, the problem here is that we see some evidence, some of the stories in the last little while from south of the border, but even right here in this community.
Mm-hmm.
About there, some people seem to be relinquishing their sense of community. And yet this event that you guys are doing, I think, reinforces the fact that, no, that's still there. We have to foster that, and we have to encourage this sort of thing, to have that sort of communication, interfaith, ethnicity, et cetera. And it can happen. And you guys are really, you're the ones that are keeping that going right now.
And it's a joy to do it. And Hillel and I are having a great time musically, too. And get bringing Jordan Abrams in as well, and just other talented musicians. It's really, really good to have fun doing it on, you know, for a good cause. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's get into the plug. When is this going to be happening?
This coming Sunday, January 21st, doors open at 6:30 p.m. at Beth Jacob Synagogue, 375 Aberdeen Avenue here in Hamilton.
Okay, and that's on Aberdeen between Lock and Dunder, and everybody has passed by there, I'm sure, dozens of times. Many of us have visited the synagogue.
Yeah.
Easy to get to. Should be an awful lot of fun. All sorts of entertainment. There'll be some food there.
Oh, the food. Can I just say that I didn't know what this dairy was. Is it Lowther? Is that how you
Loweth.
Loweth Dairy. I looked it up, and it's a kosher, you know, it's a...
It's a dairy farm that's an example for the whole world, really, on how to run an ethical farm. It's really amazing. David Loweth goes around the world to lecture people and teach them how to run dairy farms.
And it means that you'll have coffee with cream, with kosher dairy.
Yeah, we have coffee there. A Vintage Coffee Roasters is supplying us with a wonderful coffee bar. We have Andrea Levy providing us with pastries, and David Levy with the chocolate bar, and a lot of different options there, and all the proceeds from all the food sales as well to Taste Buds.
Should be an awful lot of fun. It's this coming Sunday at Beth Jacob Synagogue. Congratulations in advance for the great work that you guys have put into this, and I know everybody's going to have a blast. And
thanks a lot
for coming in today.
Thank you, Bill, for having us.
We have to do a short time out, then we're back. The Bill Kelly Show, 900 CHML. 900.